The Texas Parks and Wildlife television series is funded in part by a grant from the Wildlife and Sport Fish Restoration Program. Through your purchases of hunting and fishing equipment and motorboat fuels, over $50 million in conservation efforts are funded in Texas each year. Additional funding provided by Ram Trucks. Guts. Glory. Ram. Coming up on Texas Parks and Wildlife.
So we're up in the Panhandle of Texas, and we're studying mule deer movements and survival.
They stair-step their management, trying to cause some disturbance on a yearly basis, but not to the entirety of the property.
I've gone by and talked to them a couple of times, and just to reassure them that we're gonna get through this, we'll get through this together.
Texas Parks and Wildlife, a television series for all outdoors.
Are you in contact with the helicopter?
Yes.
All right, so we're here at 660 still. I don't know where the chopper is. They should be able to spot us, I think.
From the back of a pickup truck to the seat of a helicopter, these Texans are on the hunt. But they aren't after trophies or meat. They're hunting for knowledge.
So we're up in the Panhandle of Texas, and we're studying mule deer movements and survival, and particularly how those are influenced by agriculture.
This is the first study of its kind that we've ever done in the state of Texas. Because of the many partnerships that we have established in this project, we were able to really finally get it going. We're gonna get some outstanding information to make the best management decisions that we can for mule deer in the state of Texas.
Mule deer are a very interesting species. People think about them in the western U.S., but we do have them here in fairly healthy populations in Texas.
They're not found throughout the state like white-tailed deer are, so they're pretty much restricted to the Panhandle or the Trans-Pecos area.
They need less brush. They need lots of open expanse habitats compared to a white-tailed deer.
But just like whitetail, mule deer are an animal people love to see.
Yeah, I can see one right in the horizon.
That's a big-bodied deer, too.
Mm-hmm.
Landowners depend on them as a source of income for leasing their property for hunting. So they are important to this area. And yet we know very little about them. Very little research has been done on them here in the Panhandle.
From row crop farming, to pastures for livestock production, to plenty of wide open, wild spaces, the Panhandle of Texas is the epitome of rural. And mule deer can be found just about anywhere. Just ask a local.
It's not unusual to nearly be able to walk plumb up on a mule deer or drive up on one. If they're out in the field next to the highway, you can stop and take pictures of them.
In the fall and winter, large groups of mule deer can be found grazing in wheat fields.
It's not uncommon for us to see 150, 200 a day this time of the year.
One of the big questions of this project is dealing with agriculture land versus the rangeland like you see behind me. Is there a difference in the nutritional value of the plants, or is it the deer picking it just because it's out here and they have a buffet?
To help answer this question, researchers are looking at mule deer location data to determine what they like to eat.
Here is a doe. This is a cotton field, and it also grows wheat during the winter, so she was using the crops in the area very frequently over the course of the year.
They are also collecting native plants and poop samples.
We're basically identifying the plant DNA found in the fecal material, and we did observe the deer eating sand chenery oak and sand sage, so that gives us an idea of what we should be finding in the sample.
Another question is, how far are mule deer willing to travel for a bite to eat?
There's thoughts both from the agency standpoint and also from landowner standpoint that these mule deer may be showing large movements relative to different agricultural crops, 10 or 20 miles maybe.
That can impact the way we survey the deer. That can impact the way we issue antlerless mule deer permits. If we're issuing permits in a certain area, are we impacting neighbors far away that we had no idea that we would be impacting?
To answer these questions, the research team is tracking mule deer using radio collars.
So we've actually got two different kinds of collars. On the fawns, we've got a collar that emits a radio signal. Those enable us to tell where the deer is and if the deer's alive or not.
Right, that it was under a barbed wire fence. So that's an indication that it broke off. The stitching will expand on its own as the fawn grows. Sometimes it gets hung up in other things and will come off before the fawn is full grown.
The other kind of collars that we're putting on the adult deer have a GPS unit built into them. And so those collars are taking locations every hour for a year. So we'll get thousands of locations on those deer day and night, every day of the year.
The tricky part is getting the radio collars on the mule deer.
We have deer that are radio collared that we captured back in 2015. The radio collars all transmit a signal.
Oh, there.
Those radio collars are allowing the helicopter crew to use radio telemetry and locate them.
Normally it takes them a little while to get the feel for the country and how the animals are acting and how they react to the helicopter before they bring us an animal.
They're going to fly to that animal, get it in an open area, fire a net around it, and that net's going to hobble them up. They'll have a gentleman get out and secure them with straps and bands. And hook it up to a line underneath the helicopter. And the helicopter will long line it in, then gently lower it to the ground for us to work on.
The team works quickly to download the collar data and take a bunch of other measurements.
We've got a huge gamut of things that we're collecting on the deer while we have them in hand. We don't normally have deer in hand.
It's just me.
Yeah. We're getting body weights, we're getting body condition, meaning how much fat they have on them. Fat for humans isn't necessarily a good thing, but for wildlife, having some extra fat on them is a really good thing.
So body condition 3 and 5 millimeters of fat.
That helps them survive the hard times, and the females will be able to reproduce better if they have more fat.
Nothing.
Okay.
So that's a really good measure of kind of habitat quality for these animals.
Yeah.
While it is amazing to be close to such magnificent animals, at the same time you have to be calm because these animals can pick up on any emotion like that.
There's a high interest in this research project, not only from the department and our partners, but from private landowners as well.
Not every day that you get to see two mule deer swinging out from underneath a helicopter.
Been real interesting. It's a lot better than digging post holes or fixing fence.
I got that one off my dad's place.
It's not a typical thing that we get to see, and it's a pretty amazing project.
We were able to capture a lot of deer today.
See, he was a yearling last year. He's gonna look pretty nice to people out in the field. I mean, look at that body on him for a two-year-old. Looks like a hoss.
Really excited to see the changes that have occurred in the deer from 1 year to the next.
Do you have his weight on there? I'm just curious.
112 last year. What did he weigh?
165. Yeah, he's some weight.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. Okay, oh, that's fantastic.
One, two, three.
The deer seem to be doing really good in this area, and we're excited to find out more about where they've been all year and what they've been doing.
For now, researchers will continue to monitor the deer and their various food sources.
Tails up. I think we got poop.
Each day brings more insight.
If we look at her GPS tracks, you can see that she went back and forth between the two areas quite frequently.
If this agriculture is a good nutritional resource for the deer, we would expect those deer that are using agricultural fields to have more fat, be heavier, larger body sizes, may have larger antler sizes.
There's a lot of things in there of how we do business that this information is really gonna fine tune and make mule deer management better for the state and the Texas Panhandle.
This project was funded in part by a grant from the Wildlife Restoration Program.
The governor of Texas has declared a state of emergency for 70 counties.
The town of West looks like a war zone tonight.
Constable is dead after being shot behind a courthouse in Baytown this morning.
Often in their darkest hour, when they don't feel like there's any hope at all there, we show up and we're able to help those folks. The CIT program is a program that was started with the game wardens. Our goal is to reduce the effects of stress on our officers' lives.
You never see us until something bad happens. When something bad happens, we roll in. We serve an unbelievable role for Texas Parks and Wildlife.
It's really the emotional side of things that are hardest to get over. You know, we can understand things logically, but that doesn't mean that we forget the sounds or the thoughts or, you know, the feeling that we had when that happened.
So the critical incident team can respond to all different types of situations. Recently we responded to the murder of a deputy constable here in the Houston area.
Officers gathered for a prayer circle earlier today.
Natural disasters.
A hurricane is expected to move into northeast Texas later tonight.
Sometimes it's drownings. Unfortunately, as game wardens, we're a big part of recovering drowning victims.
It really came out of the death of a game warden, Wesley Wagstaff, in 2003. After that incident, we thought we could do things better. We thought we could respond better and give our people more training so that we could address those situations and deal with family and be more responsive.
Since its inception, it's kind of spilled over into we help other divisions, we help other agencies, and we certainly help the public.
The tornado plowed through an area 35 miles long.
We've had incidents as recent as the tornadoes that happened up in North Texas. And our personnel responding to that community. You know, these folks, they live in that community, they breathe that community, they're a part of that community.
We had several tornadoes come through right through the middle of Canton, but we've got extensive damage from one end of the county all the way to the other end of the county. There was two officers that were affected down in Fruitvale. Both their houses got leveled. I've gone by and talked to them a couple of times and just to reassure them that we're gonna get through this, we'll get through this together. Somebody just to be there to lean on, you know, a shoulder to lean on and an ear to listen to.
Seeing officers that have been through these critical incidents and are struggling, to look in their eyes and really see into their soul and see the hurt and recognize that because you've been there.
confronted by three armed men who pointed their weapons at our game warden and disarmed him.
You can't afford to show emotions while you're there. And as a result, a lot of times officers never deal with those emotions. It just stays inside of them and builds up like a pressure cooker until the lid blows off.
They just need to know what they're going through is normal, and they're not in it alone.
It takes a unique type of person that really stands up and wants to do the job. That's what we look for, is those people that really stand up and raise their hand and say, this is for me, it's not for everybody.
What you're doing as a CIT member is you're volunteering to take other people's burdens on and to help them carry those burdens. They become a part of who you are also.
You don't always have the answers. You don't always know what to say. But being there for those game wardens, being there for those employees, is what it's all about.
Looks pretty good. These are our grapes. I think this is the red one. Hopefully we'll have a crop.
See what happens.
For Rod and Mary Hench, the garden here on their ranch is a source of fresh food and a few discussions.
I want vegetables, he wants wildlife. Unfortunately, the wildlife are eating my vegetables. So there's a little conflict there.
Yeah. I've trained bird dogs and chased quail all over the Panhandle in West Texas, and that's my real love, and that's what kind of got us going on this place. We acquired this about 14 years ago. It's a little over 6,000 acres. Probably didn't know enough at that point of what we're really getting ourselves into. It needed a lot of work.
It'll take probably a couple years to heal back, but
they've definitely developed a good system here on the property. They've broken down the large property of 6,000 acres into smaller management units that they rotate their different treatments. They stair-step their management, trying to cause some disturbance on a yearly basis, but not to the entirety of the property. And what they're trying to do is kind of reset the ecological clock there and promote in some areas some forbs and things of that nature that are going to benefit the quail and deer. After that, they kind of let those areas rest for a few years before they come back and disturb it again. They've made a tremendous impact in the time that they've had it.
While Rod's main wildlife focus has been quail, the changes he's made have allowed several other species on the ranch to flourish as well.
We bring in lots and lots of dove each year, and deer have probably gone from one for every 30 acres to one for every 20 acres. We have a real healthy herd of mule deer. Turkeys have gone from nothing to probably 200 on here.
There aren't many trees tall enough for the turkeys to safely roost in at night, which keeps them out of the reach of the animals that want to eat them.
So we put up 440 of these cedar stays up in these trees. After we did that, we now have about 200 turkeys that are wintering on us.
It's night and day compared to what it had been. And now they've kind of flipped the script and have become mentors to some of their fellow landowners in the area, helping to guide conservation on their own properties. They're the perfect image of a land steward.
I am not the wildlife manager, but I support what he does. I am pleasantly surprised at the growth of the wildlife and what he's been able to accomplish. However, they do get into my garden, and that's probably a downside.
Well, she gets me involved in lots of things, and I get her involved in lots of things. But garden, I try to stay away from that as best I can.
This is our asparagus.
Despite their somewhat different areas of interest, Rod and Mary are glad to have their own little piece of the rolling plains to share with their kids and grandkids and friends.
You know, you kind of got to look at yourself in the mirror, and when you can look and say, yeah, you know, I've worked at this and, you know, it's kind of gone okay. That helps me in the morning. That kind of charges my battery and That's the reason that we do it. It's just to see if we can make a difference. I think we have.
Got a great variety of trails out here in the Franklin Mountains. Out here on the northeast side of the Franklins, you've got anything from beginner level, pretty easygoing, smooth, well-maintained trails. Right, dropping down in the Dead Man's Drop in the North Hill section of the Franklin Mountains. Woo! And then you can progress on into intermediate, get some good downhill sections as well. And the closer you get to the base of the mountains and farther up into the hills here, you get some great technical advanced level rides. Oh, geez. The Franklin Mountains here are an excellent mecca for mountain biking. Within city limits, this entire park here is about 26,000 acres. Over 100 miles of trail, again, from beginner on up to advanced.
We're at the Franklin Mountain State Park, the Tom Mays Unit. This is like the original state park here in El Paso. Ooh.
It's rough. You don't ever get a chance to just sit back and just pedal and relax. You're always having to think about something. Not to hit the rock, not to run into the cactus, not to fall off the cliff. It's gnarly for sure.
This side of the mountain, the trails go on for about, I'd say a good 20 to 30 miles of mountain bike trails.
Whoa, Nelly.
Single track, real rough, rocky, very technical, challenging terrain over here.
It's really neat where you can take these things up on the mountains, and it's kind of a stress reliever for me. If I don't ride, I get pretty grumpy and angry. So the riding itself just makes me get through the day a lot easier, and it's just fun.
You're in a pretty fabulous place, just minutes away from the city, but kind of lost in wilderness. Really, I mean, you can start as a novice, beginner, and work your way all the way up to becoming an advanced rider, all here within Franklin Mountain State Park.
This series is funded in part by a grant from the Wildlife and Sport Fish Restoration Program. Through your purchases of hunting and fishing equipment and motorboat fuels, over $50 million in conservation efforts are funded in Texas each year. Additional funding provided by Ram Trucks. Guts. Glory. Ram.